Hello YouTube. In this video, we will take a unique look at six of the most popular 35mm full-frame lenses on the market. This will be a mega shootout between Canon, Nikon, Tamron, Sony, Sigma, and Samyang, all mounted on a Sony A7S full-frame mirrorless camera. The apertures of these lenses range from f1.4 to 2.8, and all of them cost less than $1,000 US. The first up in the running of this contest is the Canon glass. This is the first EF 35mm prime lens on the market to come with image stabilization. For that matter, wide angle and standard lenses rarely come with optical stabilization, so it would seem to be a good choice for video recording. Released in 2012, it replaced the long overdue older 1990 version that was made back in the film era. Canon loyalists never get tired of that pleasing EF look that matches the collection of Canon lenses that they have already invested in. So this EF 35mm IS USM will fit right in. Second up is the 2014 model Nikon 35mm G series. It is the newest among Nikon's long list of 35mm primes and offers good value for money. Nikon lenses are not normally adapted to Sony cameras, but EF mount lenses are, so it will be interesting to test it out on an A7S with a special Nikon F or G mount adapter that I will be using, as it is different than my EF version. If it works, then one could potentially take advantage of Nikon's very modern and fuller lineup of prime lenses than what Canon and the other companies in the running have. This 2015 Super Performance Series model from Tamron is the newest of the six. It is Tamron's first ever 35mm prime lens in the modern era. This new SP35mm seems to be inspired by Sigma's Art series, with its modern black exterior and sophisticated internal design. Like the Canon, it is the only other lens in this shootout that has optical stabilization. Sony's very own enters the contest as the lightest weight of all the contenders, but certainly not the cheapest. It is the only focus-by-wire lens in the running, so the movement of the focus ring is measured electronically instead of mechanically. However, most people don't like that for manual-focused video recording. As a native full-frame E-mount lens, it doesn't need an adapter to mount it to the camera. This lens is also tiny and could easily fit in your pocket. But we will see if size matters, and to whom. This lens from Sigma probably needs no introduction, as the Art series of lenses have been storming the market for several years now. It is a heavy one, but it has a reputation for its impeccable image quality. It will indeed be interesting to see if the other lenses in the running even stand a chance. Last up is Samyang's unique offering, here branded as Rokinon, that is very special because it is the only manual focus lens in the running. It is the only cinema lens in the contest and has the largest T-stop rating of the six, so it lets in a ton of light. As a 2011 model, it is also the oldest lens within this shootout and might just be the cheapest in the running too. And if that's not enough, and although this particular copy is a Canon EF mount, Sony A7 users will be glad to know that it is in fact available in E-mount, so like the Sony, an adapter would not be needed. So before we begin the examination, here is a quick overview of the main categories of the shootout. Let's get started, shall we?
By slowly unboxing all six of them one at a time.
Yeah, right. How about we just get on with it, okay? Here we go. Let's mount each of the lenses to the A7S, starting with the Canon EF mount adapter. It attaches nicely. Now I'll put the Canon lens into the adapter, and it did so easily with no resistance. The Nikon lens requires the Nikkor mount adapter, and it is quite stiff to install. Fortunately, the lens itself mounted with ease. The EF mount adapter goes back on, and the Tamron was comfortable to adapt. The Sony lens doesn't require an adapter, and was only a little bit stiff, but not bad. The Sigma does require an adapter, and I found it was really stiff. My EF mount copy of the Samyang lens also requires an adapter, but you could also get the E-mount version of this lens if you prefer. This copy fit into the adapter just fine. Now let's take a look at the performance of the focus rings. The Canon focus ring has a travel path of almost half a turn, which is a fair amount, but it was not very ergonomic because the ring is kind of thin and was also a bit on the stiff side, but not bad though. In the past, I used to own this lens, and I think I remember it being smoother than this copy, but I can't prove it. So I'll just say that compared to the other lenses in the running, the Canon focus ring is not bad, but not great either. The focus ring on the Nikon lens felt so plasticky that I could feel the gears turning inside. The smoothness of the focus ring was overly soft and not well damped. And if you wiggle it a bit, you can feel some slop in it. At a quarter turn of focus travel, the travel path from infinity to the other end is quite short. One good thing I can say about it, though, is that the focus grip is wide and easier to grab than the Canon. The Tamron lens, however, was very smooth at focusing and dampened just right so that the focus pole drag is not too much or too little. The grip on the ring is nice and wide, so it's easy to find without looking, and the travel path turns just over half a turn. That is quite a long travel and allows you to focus manually with greater precision than the shorter focus travel paths of the Canon and Nikon. Very similar to the Tamron was the focus ring on the Sony that feels very smooth to turn and also well dampened for a fairly pleasant focusing experience, only that the focus ring is so close to the body that larger hands might feel a little cramped. The focus ring travels just over half a turn like the Tamron, except that due to its much smaller size, the Sony has a shorter travel distance from infinity to the other end than the Tamron, even though the degree of travel paths are roughly the same. I didn't have any problem with this lens's focus by wire system. It handled just like the mechanically coupled lenses, with no lag. I wonder if that's because the camera's autofocus was disabled. I'm not sure about that yet, but I was expecting much worse. The focus ring on the Sigma lens was almost identical to the Tamron ring regarding smoothness and dampening, only the Sigma was just a hair stiffer. The focus rings on both of them seemed to share the same design, nice and wide, easy to access, and visually similar. But unlike the Tamron, the Sigma's focus travel path is only a quarter turn, so quite short. And finally, I found that the focus ring of the Samyang was the smoothest of them all, but it didn't have much dampening though. There is a certain amount of drag that I like to feel so that focus poles have a nice ease-in and ease-out touch. Like the Canon, the focus travel path was almost half a turn. The aperture ring was also very smooth. The Samyang aperture ring is also the only declicked aperture ring, or on the camera it would be the dial, and permitted some smooth fade-in and out exposure effects. In summary, my least favorite focus ring in this contest was the Nikon. Even though it works well enough, it was like driving an old beater. You will get there, but it will be a rough ride. And the focus travel path is only a mere quarter turn, which in my opinion is a bit too short for manual focused video work. In fifth place was the Canon. It too can get the job done just fine, but the focused ring was a bit stiff, and even if it wasn't, it's too thin for my liking. Fortunately though, the travel path is quite a bit longer than the Nikon. I put the Samyang in fourth place because it's noticeably smoother to operate than the Canon and Nikon, but at the same time, the drag resistance is quite weak for handheld operation. Perhaps configuring this lens with a follow focus system would solve that, but that is conjecture outside of the scope of this review. Third place was a tough and subjective decision between the Sony and the Sigma focus rings because they are both so smooth and well dampened. You can't go wrong with either one. This might be splitting hairs, but I put the Sigma in third place because its focus travel path is only a quarter turn, whereas the Sony is just over half a turn, so quite a bit more. Also, The Sony allows the camera to display a focus range from near to far on the camera's LCD screen, something that cannot be done on the Sigma, or any of the other lenses in this shootout. And finally, I put the Tamron in first place. It wasn't as smooth as the Samyang, but it was just as smooth as the Sony, which is good, and not quite as stiff as the Sigma. Unlike the Samyang, though, the Tamron had just the right amount of dampening, or drag, and tied with the Sony for the longest travel path at just over one half turn for comfortable and precise manual-focused video work. Now it's time for the all-important image quality test. We will focus on each lens's three widest f-stops that I will refer to as ultimate, penultimate, and antepenultimate as the basis for comparing sharpness levels, mainly because this is the range of the aperture where the greatest improvement of state changes occur, where sharpness levels increase the most. In this part of the range, sharpness levels do reach their pinnacle, but they do not change much, if at all, from one stop to another following the direction of the arrow. When you spend a lot of money on a lens, it is on the widest three f-stops that you want to perform really well. We start off by focusing on the upper center of the middle pineapple. The least sharp lens at the wide open aperture is the Samyang. The Nikon lens improved upon the pineapple's detail quite a bit, but the Canon, Tamron, and Sigma lenses all equally improved just a hair over the Nikon. But between these three, I couldn't tell the difference. Now the Sony was a tough call for first place, as it edged out the previous three by maybe 1%. It was that close, so a minor victory at best. That's what first looks like next to the last. And this doesn't count, but my zoom lens beat them all. At least in the center of the image. So we'll go to the corner now and focus on the corner pineapple. The poor Samyang was the dullest again, but actually I don't think that the Sigma was any better. But it sure is brighter. The Nikon was just a tad sharper, but I think the Canon finally reaches good sharpness levels in the corner. To my eyes, the Tamron looked just as sharp as the Canon, except it is brighter and a little less contrasty, so they both tied for second place. In the end, it was the Sony that reached the level of excellence in the corner of the ultimate aperture test. Curious to know if the zoom lens beat it this time? Don't worry, it didn't, but it was darn close though. I'd say it tied with the Canon and Tamron though. Here is the Sony next to the Sigma for reference. So with all the lenses wide open, that was a clean sweep for the Sony, both in the center and in the corner. Now let's do the same test at the penultimate aperture, where lens performance, including sharpness, increases the most. The Sony should have more competition now. And it does, but in fact, I'm going to have to disappoint those expecting me to split hairs in this test, because they all look the same to me. After much examination, the details that do differ are brightness levels and distribution, color, contrast, etc., but the one important detail that I'm looking for eluded me, image sharpness. I'm not sure if my intuition is correct here, but I think that the Sigma is the sharpest. But I'm not sure. Maybe it's the fact that it has the best contrast and color that makes it look nicer than the others. For example, the Tamron has a bit weaker contrast. Perhaps my methods are just not scientific enough to discern the difference of sharpness in each lens in this test, at least not in the center. Maybe I just need more megapixels. So let's take a look at the corner pineapple with the Sigma. That's not very sharp, unfortunately. The Samyang improves upon the Sigma with a noticeable amount of detail, and already we come to a three-way tie for second place. Will the Sony finally lose this time? Well, the Canon, Nikon, and Tamron lenses all looked a bit sharper than the Samyang, but equal to each other, including the zoom lens, which doesn't count. The Tamron still having just a bit weaker contrast. The Sony lens is on a conquest at first place again. The detail of even corner resolution is just amazing. Here is the Sony's center and corner images side by side at f4, and it looks like the Sony gives up little to nothing in the corners compared to the center with respect to sharpness. Here is the first and the last side by side for reference. And here are the Sigma's center and corner images for reference. Another stellar performance from the Sony. Now let's move on to the antepenultimate aperture. Interestingly, the zoom lens was the softest, but more importantly was a five-way tie between the Canon, Nikon, Tamron, Sony, and the Samyang for second place. They all appeared equally sharp to me, but one lens did stand out though. The Sigma lens at f2.8 is razor sharp in the center. Finally, we have confirmed a non-Sony winner. Here is the Sigma next to the Sony now. And here are the three different apertures of the Sigma on the center pineapple. And it performed good even at f1.4. However, I think that the Samyang showed the most center improvement from the ultimate to the antepenultimate. Now let's go to the corner pineapple with the Sigma. I was hoping to start off with something else. The Samyang improves in sharpness around the sides and the head of the pineapple. Now, I can't tell the difference between the Nikon and the Tamron, except that they are both a bit sharper than the Samyang. And I can't tell the difference between the Canon and the Sony, except that they are both a bit sharper yet than the previous two. Along comes the zoom lens at 35mm and did them all in. The Canon's corner image at antepenultimate looks quite good, including good brightness levels. Here it is compared to the Sigma's antepenultimate corner. Let's see if the Sigma can improve by stopping down to f4. Yeah, it does. It's a bit better now. Well, that concludes the sharpness testing within each lens's three widest aperture stops. But we will do one more test at the lowest common aperture by putting all the lenses at f2.8. We start off again with the center pineapple, the Canon, and the Nikon. This was a tough test to judge because they were all so close, where any differences could only be seen by pixel peeping. The Tamron and Sony looked the same, and showed just a little bit more detail. The Samyang is looking very sharp here, but to the right is the same image of the Sigma of which I said earlier that it's razor sharp. And that still holds true next to the other lenses even at the same aperture. Now we will take a look at the corner pineapple images at f2.8 where the Sigma falls from a greater height. The Samyang is just barely any better, and the Nikon is looking moderately sharp. The Canon and Tamron lenses both improve equally over the Nikon and are looking really sharp, but the sharpest corner image goes to the Sony. So I totaled up the scores from all the various tests in an arbitrary but consistent way and determined the overall sharpness from the least to the greatest. Bear in mind that numbers are subjective and can be calculated in many different ways. The Sony did indeed turn out a stellar performance by pixel peeping, but for most people's usage, all of these lenses render sharp enough images. And if you were like me and record 1920x1080 video, a fairly small resolution, then spotting a dull hair on a pineapple is an unlikely factor. I think that photographers who use large megapixel cameras would be much more concerned about it. But for what it's worth, the viewer is welcome to make their own conclusion from the data. Now let's do a lens stabilization test. But in this lineup, only the Canon and the Tamron lenses have optical stabilization mechanisms built into the lens, so those are the two that we are going to take a look at. For handheld video recording, I think that most people using any of these A7 series cameras would be attracted to either the Canon or the Tamron lens. Alternatively, the second generation of these cameras have what is called 5-axis in-body image stabilization, which would not actually require the use of the optical stabilization feature that is built into the lens that actually only stabilizes on three axes anyways. In my case though, the A7S doesn't have IBIS technology, so this keeps the good old optical stabilization alive and current in the discussion. So let's take a look at them now. Starting here with the Canon lens, handheld, and no image stabilization. And now it's turned on. Here is the Tamron lens with the VC turned off. Now it is turned on. If we view them side by side, we can see that the Tamron is noticeably jerkier than the Canon. Both lenses were silent, not producing any humming, which is nice to know, but the Canon IS clearly stabilized the footage better than the Tamron VC. Moving along now to the distortion test, my room was not quite as evenly lit as it could have been, so I do apologize for that. But it's not bad though. All images will be shown at f5.6. The Sony has the strongest distortion, and it is also the only one that pincushions, while the others have barrel distortion, if any at all. The Samyang has almost the same amount of distortion, only it's the opposite, it's barrel distortion. The Nikon has barrel distortion too, but just not as much as the Samyang. The Canon offers a slight improvement over the Nikon for second place, and the Tamron and Sigma lenses tie for first place, as they are just 99% similar. Between the two of them, distortion levels are so well controlled that unless the objects in your scene were perfectly symmetrical, one probably would not notice any difference between them at all. Moving on to the next detail, the vignette test will be based on each lens's maximum aperture relative to specifically assigned shutter speeds in order to achieve a uniform standard of exposure across the contestants. We start off in last place with the Canon, as it vignettes very heavily in the corners, and its overall light transmission was also the lowest of the six. The Samyang was a bit brighter overall than the Canon, although it seems to vignette just as heavily in the corners as the Canon does. The Nikon lens improves upon the Samyang's corners and overall brightness. Third place goes to the Sigma because it is more consistent than the Nikon from the center of the frame to the corners, even though the transmission, or overall brightness, is a bit lower than the Nikon. So can you guess whether second place goes to the Tamron or the Sony? There's the answer. But not necessarily because it's brighter in the corners than the Sigma, but because the deal breaker is that it has better overall brightness. Note that I was not able to open the Tamron to f1.8 due to the close proximity of the camera to the grid chart, but f2 is very close though. So what makes the Tamron the winner? Simply put, it has the best center-to-corner brightness consistency. Those corners control the vignetting with excellence, such that other lenses would need to close down a stop or two just to equal the Tamron wide open. Okay, almost wide open. The lens also displays a high overall level of light transmission that is second only to the Sony. Here is a split screen of the Tamron compared to the Canon, both at f2. Stop the Canon down to f2.8 for a noticeable improvement in overall brightness, especially in the corners. Stop down again to f4 and the Canon's vignetting problem is gone, but it still isn't quite as bright overall as the Tamron. By the way, here is what my zoom lens looked like at 35mm. Its vignette is no more or less than the prime, but it sure is brighter. Wow. Perhaps the Tamron at f4 can beat it. Well, that's against the rules. I kinda wish I didn't see that. Just kidding. Alright then, let's try the Sony at f4. Oh, that's so close. But not quite. How can a zoom lens show all of them up? Oh well, life is full of surprises. We'll get over it. Okay, next. In this test, we are going to take a less clinical but different look at each lens's maximum apertures, this time using a constant shutter speed. The purpose of this is just to appreciate the true light transmission of each lens. Do you know what I mean by that? Let's take a look. I'll show you. We start off with my zoom lens at 35mm just to expand the scope, because its widest aperture is f4. Now here is the Sony at f2.8. That is one full stop greater than f4, letting in twice the amount of light. Here is the Canon at f2, doubling the light once again, from f2.8 of course. Stopping up to f1.8, the Nikon is a tiny bit brighter than the Canon, but the Tamron is also f1.8. So here they are side by side. Apart from the Tamron being a bit warmer and having some mild flaring, they are almost identical, tying for third place. So which would the best low light lens be, the Sigma f1.4 or the Samyang t1.5? Second place goes to the Samyang, making the Sigma the king of low light. This is kind of a surprise because f1.4 lenses are often rated at around t1.7 or so. But here is an example of the Sigma lens with a 5D Mark III that scored a t1.5 on DxOMark. So that's pretty good, even though that doesn't prove that an A7S plus an adapter would yield the same result. But at least it seems congruent with my own results. Next on the list is the bokeh test that will consist of four different parts in order to contrast the results between different perspectives. We start off with the daytime maximum aperture bokeh test, where each of the lenses fall within this range. In last place is the Sony. Not necessarily because it is rough looking, although it could be smoother. It's just not as blurred as the others because its largest aperture is only f2.8. Fifth place goes to the Canon, and a very close fourth goes to Nikon. I have to say that this surprised me, as others have reported that the Nikon has rougher bokeh than the Canon, but that's not quite what I'm seeing here though. Oh well, it is what it is. Let's put the Sony in there just for perspective. The third place bokeh goes to the Tamron, which by the way is at f2 due to the close focus distance of the lens. The Sigma is coming in very smooth because we are at f1.4 now, but we're not done yet. The Samyang trumps them all at t1.5, just melting away the background. Here are all three of them for perspective, and here are all six of them. One thing that the Sony can't be faulted with is that its f2.8 is very bright. Too bad it's not bokehlicious though. Just for fun, here is a quick gallery of each lens's bokeh wide open, except the Tamron. No rating will be given because the clouds and luminance kept changing, so the viewer may come to their own conclusion. Notice that the Samyang has the reddest hues? Okay, now we will do the same test at the lowest common aperture, f2.8. This will place all the lenses on the same level, but it was also much harder to discern the differences between them, as their performances were all so similar. The poor Sony lost again. It's just not very creative in the background blur department. The Canon, Sigma, and Tamron lenses were noticeably softer than the Sony, but between the three of them, I really couldn't tell them apart. So they all tied for third place. In second place is where I put the Nikon, because the Samyang lens was just that smooth. Here are all six of them just for perspective. Now we move on to the first bokeh ball test at nighttime. But first we will just take a quick look at each one, zooming in and out and toggling between bright and dark exposures before making any comparisons. Did you notice that the Tamron lens yielded the largest bokeh circles of the six? And they are the closest together, too, while the Sony lens rendered the smallest bokeh circles and are also the furthest apart. Here are the Tamron and Sony next to the others for comparison with a bright exposure. Here they are with a dark exposure, where they tend to look like onion rings, and some lenses pronounce this effect more than others, especially the Tamron. Finally, we will take a look at videos of bokeh balls to offer a perspective with movement, but this time further away from the streetlights than in the previous test. Notice how the circles become more lemon-shaped as they move towards the edges? It should also be noted that cars passing by do randomly affect the phasing of the bokeh circles to a minor extent. We'll spend another 45 seconds or so just to gallery view the remaining lenses, as they are all different. Here they are all lined up, and the biggest surprise is that the Samyang's bokeh balls were huge in this test, while the proportions of the others remained the same as we saw in the previous test. I wonder if the subject-to-lens distance had something to do with that. But if so, then why were the other lenses not affected in this way? Well, another aspect apart from size is that each lens clearly renders different seeding and phasing of the overall shape of the bokeh. The viewer may take a preference to whichever they choose as their favorite. No rating here will be given. Okay, time for the close-up focus test that will consist of a rating. This is the lens with the longest distance between the camera and subject in this shootout, which is therefore already in sixth place. Can you guess it? It's the Sony. Moving 5 centimeters closer to fifth place is the Samyang. And in fourth place is the Sigma. Note that even though the factory specified close focus distances were the same for both the Sigma and the Samyang at 30 centimeters, I was still able to get just a bit closer with the Sigma. Moving in a bit closer to third place is the Canon. But moving 1 factory-specified centimeter backward for second place is the Nikon. Yes, it is true that even though the Canon is rated for 1 centimeter of closer focusing distance than the Nikon, I was still able to get just a bit closer to the subject with the Nikon than with the Canon. I wonder if we can blame it on the adapter or something. But anyway, the Tamron wins the close focus contest, as this thing seems to approximate macro territory. Let's take one last look at the results of the close-up focus test to put them into a final perspective before we move on. Look at the difference between the Tamron and the Sony. Well, that was quick. Now let's do a series of sun flare tests. There will be 3 of them, and so we start with the front of a house and the flariest performer. Can you believe it? The Sigma. 5th place goes to the Samyang, and you can see why. The Canon and the Tamron lenses were very close. I had to pause them during their highest points of flare to tell the difference. I put the Canon in 4th place and the Tamron in 3rd because it controlled the flare better than the Canon for a brief moment. The difference between 1st and 2nd place was very slim. You have to see them moving to discern between them. With the Nikon, were quick reflections bouncing off the lens. But amazingly, the Sony exhibits a perfectly flare-free video. Check out the difference between first and last place. I thought the Sigma would pwn them all, with all its heavy glass elements and such. Well, actually, that probably explains why it flares so much. Anyhow, here's a comparison right from the least to the greatest. Now let's repeat these tests on a different part of the house. This is the first time in the shootout that the Tamron has ever bombed a test. The sun flare is really strong here. The Samyang was a little bit better. The Canon is looking even better. The Sigma does have strong green highlights, but at least it has more contrast than the Canon. Second place again goes to the Nikon. And what puts the Sony in first place again is its ability to render strong contrast levels with very little flaring getting through. There's the zoom lens. and one final look at them all. Although I don't think in this case that this perspective is very efficient, but there it is anyways. Alright, time to look at sun stars. This test is admittedly a bit subjective because although the speed of the wind might have been changing, which affects the phasing of the sun stars because of the leaves, at least the possible wind speed variations were not felt on the ground. So it is what it is. Also, I recorded these at f8, and in hindsight, maybe I should have done so at f11 or 16. I'm not going to formally rate them, because sun stars are not defined by rules, so to each their own on this one, but I will say that my favorite is probably the Nikon, and my least favorite is definitely the Sony. Last up, sort of, is the chromatic aberration test. Those wavelengths of light that get refracted away from a common focal plane, causing green and purple color fringing. If there is a so-called proper way to do this test, then I admit to being unclear about it, but I came up with a set in which the text can be seen to color fringe in the out-of-focus areas. So for better or worse, here is a gallery view of each lens's maximum f-stop, where chroma levels are the strongest. But it seems that green and purple fringing is affected in part by brightness levels, particularly contrast, which I might not have enough of. My intention was to affect the chroma levels exclusively by adjusting the f-stops, but it didn't go as planned. So I'm not sure of a way to harmonize the data, therefore I will not rate them. If anyone has advice for me, then please feel free to leave a comment in the box below. I'm afraid that autofocus is excluded from this shootout for several good reasons. The A7S itself is quite slow at autofocusing, and even if it wasn't, none of the adapters I used are capable of autofocus anyways. Also, the Samyang lens is manual focus only. So now after all the testing, it's time to draw some conclusions. I assigned performance values to each of the lenses for most of the tests, and totaled them up, and this is what I came up with. It's a general overview, nothing specific. Like I said earlier, numbers don't mean much as there are many ways to process numbers, and this is but one way. For example, this score chart doesn't contain scores from the sun stars or chromatic aberration results, and a few others where no rating was given, but such could just as well have been done and therefore alter the final scores greatly. It just depends on one's criteria. Statistics are interesting, and they have their place, but they are subjective. I think that there is a more objective way of rating these lenses, one that is practical, being whichever the details that matter the most to you. Everyone has their favorites, including myself, which I will state plainly as focus ring performance, vignetting, optical stabilization, and of course, image quality, but no more so than the aforementioned. In my case, my personal favorite lens was the Tamron, as it had the best all-around performance, with an excellent focus ring, good overall brightness levels. It's not small, but it's not big and heavy either. It has optical stabilization on it, which is better than what most lenses have. After the Tamron, the lens that grabbed my attention the most was the Sony. It seemed to be the most peculiar of the six because it often did either really well or really poorly. The fact that it is so small, light, and doesn't require an adapter is an advantage in itself, including that it panders to the allure of the mirrorless system's attractive small form factor. It doesn't let in much light for a prime lens, but its image quality was amazingly good, especially in the corners. Its background blur was quite weak, but handles sun flare like a boss. I find myself ruminating over how different the Sony and Tamron lenses are, almost like different tools for different jobs, whereas by comparison, the other lenses seem to compete more with the Tamron than with the Sony. After the Tamron and the Sony, I feel that I could go either way with the Canon or the Nikon. The Nikon did score a few more points than the Canon, but that doesn't really mean much in action. They both have their unique advantages. The Canon has that IS that I love, and admittedly lament because I own the Tamron, and its VC is a step down from the IS. And the EF mount adapter permits aperture control with the camera dial. On the Nikon, however, it is controlled by the adapter's ring. It is not as comfortable or practical, at least in my view. However, the Nikon handled sun flaring really well, almost like the Sony, yet unlike the Sony, it has a much larger aperture. And the other thing is that this lens is easy to find on the used market for really cheap, at least in the Vancouver area on Craigslist. So for good overall, lightweight performance, the Nikon can do it for cheap. I will admit to being underwhelmed by the Sigma, partly because I was expecting the most from it. It has quite a reputation on the market, but for myself, I found that there are smaller and cheaper lenses that at the least equal what the Sigma can do, and at the best, offer more than the Sigma does. It is by all means a great lens. If you want to see in the dark, this is the one. Its center sharpness was certainly there, but not in the corners it wasn't. This lens also costs more than the other five, and it is very heavy. When it's in your hand, you can feel it, and I don't like that. For what my needs are in a 35mm lens, I felt that I could get them both in lighter and cheaper alternatives. And finally, my least preferred lens was the Samyang Rokinon, mostly because, like the Sigma, of its weight and size. It is a large lens without the adapter that gets 20mm longer when mounted on the adapter. And even if one does use the E-mount version of this lens, that version itself is 26mm longer than the EF version, gaining 6mm in length and 5 grams in weight. Also, its vignette and overall brightness levels were not very impressive to me, which is a shame because these are among my favorite qualities in a lens. But if price and bokeh performance were my top priorities, then this lens would have been my top priority. By price, what I mean is, its retail price is quite low, but its second-hand price on Craigslist is really low, even lower than the Nikon. If you look around, you can get this lens for an absolute steal, making it the most value for the money. Congratulations if you made it this far. I do hope that you enjoyed this video and found it useful. This was not my first review video, but it was my first lens review video. I have aspirations to make more of these shootout videos, such as with 20mm lenses, and numerous others too. I do have a Patreon page if anyone would like to help me out with these endeavors. Otherwise, thanks again for watching.